Hi, I'm Becky here with lifetimehub.com, and I have the beautiful June joining me today. So, June, we are going to be talking about your son, Christopher, and kind of how would you describe Christopher, and maybe that he needs special attention?
Oh, it's very difficult to describe Christopher. Christopher is now 18.
Okay.
And I have two other children, and he's the middle child. He has special needs. He has physical and learning difficulties. When he was 4 years of age, he was diagnosed with learning and physical difficulties. That basically means that there wasn't a condition, you know, they couldn't find a label for him.
Oh, okay.
And that made life very difficult.
Yeah.
His entire, it's quite complicated. He was born with undescended testes.
Yeah.
And I thought that's all, and that was bad enough, but that was, I thought, the entirety of the problems.
Okay.
When he was born. But as he developed, you could see he took his time, he was slow to walk, to talk. He did all of the milestones that children reach, he took twice as long to get there.
Okay. Still just thought he was...
Well, as I said, he was born with undescended testes,
yeah.
And they had an operation when he was 18 months old to bring down the testes in the hopes that by the time he moved into any level of awareness, he would look and feel normal.
Right.
Because they operated on his testes at 18 months, when all those milestones came and went, I put it all down to the operation.
Oh.
I kept thinking that took an awful lot out of him, he's going to be slower, and I was just minding him so carefully, yeah. And so concerned about him. But in hindsight now, I can see, of course, there were other signs, but I wouldn't have. I was in complete denial from the time he was born. I just didn't. It's not that I didn't want to know. I couldn't cope.
Okay.
So I pushed it to the back of my mind, any signs that I got.
Okay.
And I just refused to believe there was anything wrong with him until age four. A developmental check, I was told by a nurse that, yeah, he was. There was some difficulties there, that he wasn't. He wasn't reaching all of his targets.
Okay.
And she felt that he needed an assessment. And of course, I couldn't believe that I didn't notice it before then. Because
right.
A simple little test at the developmental appointment, the nurse asked him to stand on one foot.
Yeah.
And he couldn't do it. Oh. I kept trying to, you know, he kept holding onto things, or he'd fall, or he couldn't. And I thought, God, that's odd.
Yeah.
You know? And yeah. I mean, this was sticking out a mile before that, but I was in complete denial.
Yeah.
So when the nurse actually said to me, no, there's a problem, I went into shock. I went home and told my husband, and he said straight away, yeah, I always thought there was something wrong with him. And I couldn't believe what I was hearing.
Okay.
And of course, it took me several days to stop crying. Mm. I was so upset that there might be something wrong with my child.
Yeah.
And that's just devastating.
Yeah.
So it took me a few days now to get over that, but once I calmed down and stopped crying, I just said, right, okay, if there is something wrong, I want to know what it is
right,
and what I've
okay.
got to deal with.
Yeah.
So then we brought him into the hospital. They did a battery of tests on him, and he had so many symptoms, but they couldn't find an overall condition to fit his symptoms. But they believed, a geneticist and all they brought in, believing that there has to be some condition. He had so many symptoms.
Yeah.
And all of these things together, they believed, must have added up to some condition. But because they couldn't find, they said they just labelled him with physical and learning difficulties. And that has followed him throughout his life.
And even still, when he's 18?
Yeah, he's in a special needs school at the moment. And he'll finish up in that in this June. And I've no idea where he's going to be placed after that, or what life has in store for him.
Did you have support when you found out?
No. Or? You have to, everything you have to find out yourself. You have to research. And again, if your child is labelled with a physical or learning disability, they have no overall label. So you are left to research everything. And you're piecemeal treating them. You know, you'd see one specialist about his eyes, one about his ears, one about his kidneys.
Oh my
gosh. So nobody looked at the overall condition of the child. Mm. You were just tossed from Billy to Jack, speech therapy. There was appointments at one point. I used to feel totally stupid now. I turn up for an appointment and the doctor would say, why are you here? Or what can we do for you? And I'd be going, I don't know. You tell me. I have so many appointments. I don't even know what I'm doing anymore. But I just, my memory now just went so bad. I couldn't remember, you know, he had his feet. He had flaffy and his knees seemed to be slightly twisted, the lower limbs. He has spondylolisthesis, which is the lower vertebrae tilt inwards. Okay. So he's constantly walking with soft, bent knees.
Okay.
And it's so hard for him. He'd walk a few paces, he'd have to stop and not only wet himself, but he'd be exhausted.
Oh, God.
And this went on for years. Now, last summer he had an operation on his spine after years and years of going in. And then, of course, because of the inactivity, he constantly put on weight.
Yeah.
And they told me, you know, to keep fobbing you off, telling you, you know, he has to lose weight, you know, that's his biggest problem. But I couldn't get him exercise because he couldn't walk.
Yeah.
And, Jesus, it was horrendous.
It sounds like frustration is the biggest.
And then all the systems that are put in place, like speech therapy, you get a 6-week block of speech therapy every couple of years. And everybody I went just told me to go home and start doing exercises with him. And I had 2 other children. I was working. I was trying to get an education because I left school very early.
Right.
And it was just too much for me.
Yeah.
But every specialist you saw gave you another load of exercise. Speech therapy.
Oh,
you'd get 6 weeks a day, tell you to go home and do this, that and the other with him.
Yeah.
The physio about his legs would tell you have to do stretching exercises. And I just couldn't manage with it.
Yeah,
and that's what I felt his whole life. I had to beg for everything. I had to search for everything. There was no support.
Yeah.
But if he would have had a condition, I would have been able to slot more easily into the system. But
right.
I believe
there's
an awful lot of people like me that have with no label, just diagnosis of physical or learning or both.
Really? Okay, because I wondered if that was rare or not.
No, it's not rare.
So for the mom or dad who's watching and they just found out, or they just like you, or the shock, or the, you know, that realization, do you have advice for them of what you would say if you could do it differently, or what would you say to yourself, you know?
I don't know if I'd have done anything differently. I'm not sure if detecting it sooner, you know, if my willingness to notice it or, you know, sooner would have made any difference. I don't think so. I just recognise now that I was in denial and I didn't want to know.
Right.
But in fact, you know, of course, everybody's situation is different and levels of disability vary, you know, considerably. I do feel very blessed to have him.
Right.
He's my middle child and he is special needs, there's absolutely no doubt. I suppose he's 18 now, but emotionally and academically, I'd be lucky if he's 10.
Right,
you know, at that stage.
Okay.
Very poor reading and writing skills. But what a pleasure to have him as a child. He's loved by everybody.
Absolutely.
You know, he is so special. And I know with, you know, normal children, at a certain age, they become very independent. And in fact, their parents are an embarrassment to have them around. They don't want them involved in everything. But I know I'm going to have Christopher with me for a long time.
Yeah.
We do everything together, you know, and sometimes that can actually, you need a bit of space sometimes. But for the most part, it's lovely.
Right.
You know, he's such a happy child. He wakes up, the first thing he does when he wakes up in the morning is ask you for a kiss. He's a smile on his face.
God.
He goes in to have a shower, sings his little heart out. Like none of my other children or my husband will do that in the morning. Like he is a pleasure. And I do feel blessed. And I know people say that when special children are in a household, they bring more gifts.
Yeah.
You know, that there's so much in it that keeps you grounded.
Right.
You could have a tendency, if all your children were fine and healthy and not a problem, not really to be in touch with what's real in life and what's important in life and how important family is.
Right.
And special need children definitely do that for you.
Right.
It changes the dynamics of the whole family. And because he's sandwiched in between 2 able-bodied children, they have to make allowances now. Not all the time. I mean, there's more in my house. Christopher tends to fight more with his brothers than he does with anybody else. Everybody else thinks he's an angel, but he fights with them. And it's frustration. He wants to be heard. He wants to be included. He knows he doesn't have the same abilities.
Oh, okay.
And a lot of it is frustration, and that gets acted out. But I know they love him, and if anybody touched them, you know, they'd defend him to the death, you know.
Do you think that it's positively affected them to maybe be more compassionate?
I think it has, yeah. And again, I wouldn't be a parent all the time, you know, I mean, like, they don't really make any allowances for his conditions, yeah. And I'm glad.
Absolutely.
Because I feel that's the way it should be.
Yeah.
And that spurs him on, because he's got now two role models to imitate.
Right.
And that's fine, you know, I'm happy about that.
So is that what you would say to other parents, maybe that have a toddler and have other kids, just to tell them to get the siblings to treat that child the same?
I think families will work it out for themselves. I think the children in general, because they're part of the family, will not make any allowances.
Okay.
But I'm not sure about this. My take on it is that Christopher was in mainstream school till about 11 or 12.
Wow.
And I'm not sure if that was a good idea. There are benefits to everything and negatives. On the plus side, I thought it was good that he could emulate able-bodied children and want to be like them and strive, but in fact, with the lack of resources that existed in that school, all they did was accommodate. They were very fond of him, he's well loved wherever he goes, but there was very little interaction with him or resources piled onto him to help him.
Okay.
So in fact, when I eventually got him into a special needs school, they nearly had to start from scratch with all his bad habits of being left to do nothing.
Oh.
And that being completely acceptable for the largest portion of his childhood.
Right.
So to now try and get him to study and learn things was quite difficult.
Right.
My first concern in his youth was that he was happy. And I now, on reflection, think I might have put a bit more energy into worrying about his abilities. Now, I'm not sure if it would have made any difference.
Yeah.
Hindsight is a great thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
You don't know. You just do what's best for you and your family at the time. And at the time, his happiness was my priority. When he hit 11 or 12, I started to really consider his future.
Okay.
And now I wanted more resources put in place.
Okay.
And again, I had to fight for that. I had to prove that his physical needs outweighed his academic needs. And you were nearly fortunate that he had spondylolisthesis, flat feet, all of these other conditions. You know, it's dreadful that you have to use his condition to get him resources.
Oh, okay.
Because if he had no physical, if it was just learning difficulties that he had, he would have never accessed mainstream or special needs. He would have had to stick in mainstream where he was learning absolutely nothing.
Mm.
So it's a tough one to call because no two children are the same.
Okay, yeah.
And no needs are the same in any child.
Right.
I can only talk of my experience.
Absolutely, yeah. I just wondered, you know, is there any advice you would give, or not something you'd do different, but, you know, you didn't have a lot of support. Would you say, oh, if there is support around you, seek it out and find it? I don't know.
Yeah, of course I could say that, but who am I to, you know, be telling anybody else what to do when I didn't do it?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I do.
I mean, and you were okay, really.
Yeah, and we are okay.
Yeah.
I don't, as I said, I don't know if I'd have fought for more resources when he was younger. I suppose if I to be honest with me, my heart would tell me that, yeah, he'd be in a better place today, but I don't know that.
Yeah, absolutely. No. And I will say, I know Christopher, and he is the happiest person
I've ever met. He's a great disposition, yeah.
And since I moved to Ireland, he's my favourite person that I've met. Yeah. I mean, he is, like, joy and
love. He is. He's complete open and accepts people where they're at. And even when he went to the school, 90% of the school are wheelchair bound.
Oh.
And an average child might feel that you're placing them behind if you put them into a school where all the other children are in wheelchairs.
Right.
And he wasn't.
Okay.
But he took one look at the school and thought, yeah, happy days. He doesn't judge anybody. He's never once come home to me and criticised anybody for having a disability of any kind.
Yeah.
And I just love that about him. I just don't know where he got it. It's lovely attribute.
Absolutely,
to have, you know?
Absolutely. That's why I wanted to talk to you, because I said, what did June do? Because he's amazing.
I'm not sure. I'm sure the parents contribute. I'd love to take full credit for all the good stuff, you know. But some of it you must come into the world with, and I believe special need children do. Just, that's the gift they bring to us, you know.
Just joy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And complete openness and acceptance. And it's just wonderful. He is. He's so loving, you know.
So loving, absolutely. Yeah.
And I've all boys. I have three boys. And generally, boys get to a certain age and they're too embarrassed even giving you a kiss in front of anybody. Christopher walks down the road holding my hand and constantly asks you for a kiss.
Oh, it's lovely, you know? That is lovely. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much for being
You're
so
very
open.
Welcome.